Morning everyone, it's a lovely cool morning this morning, but I'm inside because I'm going to talk to you about four-wheel drive systems. You've seen me post a couple of times now about when you can use four-wheel drive and when you can't, and talking about full-time four-wheel drives, so-called, versus part-time four-wheel drives. So let's have a look at what is the differences and why I say what I say. Okay, so let's first have a look at the four-wheel drive selector positions that are available in the different types of cars. Now, these might be a dial on the dash that you turn or down on the center console, or they might be the traditional so-called second gear stick or little stubby gear stick. Doesn't matter what the actuator is or the interface with the driver, it matters what the positions are. So if yours looks like this, two high, four high, neutral, four low, then it's what's called a part-time four-wheel drive. You can have it in two-wheel drive, high range, four-wheel drive, high range, neutral, or four-wheel drive, low range. That's what is called a part-time four-wheel drive. Now, older part-time four-wheel drives or part-time four-wheel drives typically have freewheeling hubs. So those are the hubs in the front wheel that have the little kind of switch in the middle of them, if you like, the rotating dial where you can select locked or unlocked. Sometimes they're automatic ones where you can select locked or auto. All right, so what do you have? Do you have part-time like this or do you have full-time? So your full-time selector doesn't have a two-wheel drive position, right? And that's going to be important later. We're going to talk about how could that possibly be. So here's what one type of full-time four-wheel drive selector might look like. This is my Prado. It has a 4-high position, a 4-HL position, a 4-LL position. Those stand for four-wheel drive high range, but we'll actually learn it's not really. Four-wheel drive high range locked, four-wheel drive low range locked. And we're going to learn what the locked means. For now, I want you to think of it this way and I'll explain why. That's not really truly four-wheel drive, the 4H position. Not really truly. Because if it was, you wouldn't be able to drive the car on the road. Four high locked, that is the really truly four-wheel drive position. It corresponds with the four high in the part-time four-wheel drive. For low locked, that is really truly four-wheel drive, but with the car going slower and having more torque. In other words, more twisting power at the wheels. The other kind of setup you might see, I think Mitsubishi Pajero and others might have something like this. Four high, LC, four LC. So four-wheel drive high range, although it's not really, it's more like two-wheel drive. Four-wheel drive high range locked, the LC in this case corresponds to locked, similar to the L over here. And four-wheel drive low range locked. So both of these positions are really truly four-wheel drive, and one of them is higher speed, one of them is lower speed with more torque. So that's the selectors. Now let's talk about the systems and how they work. So I've got a schematic of the car here, and what we've got is kind of a plan view. We're looking down from the top. You can see we've got four wheels, a bit squiggly, but you get the idea. We've got front left wheel, front right wheel, rear left wheel, rear right wheel, all right? We've got an engine, we've got a gearbox, and we've got a transfer case. Then we've got tail shafts or prop shafts, if you like, that are connected to the front axle in this case, and a rear axle in that case. In between the wheels and on the axle is this round pumpkin-like thing, which you can see, particularly on the rear of most four-wheel drives, a bit harder to see on the front of some. You have this thing called a differential. So I've drawn it as a circle here, all right? So let's have a look at what happens when you are in two-wheel drive. When you're in two-wheel drive, the engine drives the gearbox and you have a range of gears available to you, manual or automatic. And that allows you to go different speeds at different revs. then there's another gearbox behind this one, and it's called a transfer case, and it selects one of two gears, either the high one or the low one. The low one means you go slow, the high one means you go normal road speeds. So that then drives the tail shaft, which drives the differential. And this differential is just like a right angle drive, if you like. What it does is it takes this spinning motion that's in this direction and turns it into a spinning motion in this direction. So it goes around the 90 degree bend. That's one of its jobs. The other job it has is actually in the name, is a clue in the name. It's called a differential because when you turn a corner, the wheels turn at different speeds, right? So you can't drive them at the same speed. Otherwise, you'd have problems. So when this corner, when this car takes a corner, this wheel here travels a longer distance than this wheel here. So when it does that, this wheel here has to coast. It can't be driven at the same speed, otherwise it would be fighting with the ground. And it might twist all this up and break something. So the differential actually allows that wheel on the inside here to coast. We'll find out why that's a good and bad thing a little later. But it is a problem for four-wheel drives. Because what we're saying now is when we're in two-wheel drive, when we turn a corner, only one wheel is driving. Remember that. It's really, really important. Now we come up to the front axle, right? We've got that, it's just spinning freely, doing nothing. There's nothing happening there except the wheels are going around, the wheels are turning the axle, the axle's turning the center of the diff, the prop shaft is turning, but nothing's connected in here. So all these things are turning around for no reason, just because the tires are running on the road. So how do we stop that? Why would we want to stop that? Well, the answer is you don't really have to stop it if you don't want to. All right? You can if you want to, if your car has freewheeling hubs. What the freewheeling hubs do is the mechanism out here on the outside of the wheel literally disconnects the wheel from the drive of the axle. So when it does that, it kind of cuts that off, if you like. And so your wheel can now turn, your axle doesn't turn, your diff doesn't turn, your prop shaft doesn't turn. Huh, right, so that's what the freewheeling hubs do. So people will say they're a good idea because they stop you wearing out your front diff. And I say to that, well, true, but what about the back one? Wouldn't you want to wear them both out at the same speed? I mean, literally, these things don't wear. They last 100 years. So, I don't buy it. I don't buy that it's to stop wear and tear. What it's to stop is fuel usage, right? You use more fuel. So don't be scared to have your hubs engaged and be in two-wheel drive. There's no real penalty. Yes, you do wear out the front diff faster than you would if you didn't, but by two parts of nothing. And even the fuel usage is not very high when you're causing the drag. So if you want to, you can leave your four-wheel drive hubs in. In fact, lots of mining companies do. So that's two-wheel drive explained, right? Now let's go to four-wheel drive. What happens when we engage four-wheel drive is through a system of gears here, we connect these two shafts together, right? So they're solidly fixed by metal gears engaged. There's no slip in there, right? So that's with four-wheel drive engaged in a part-time four-wheel drive. So when we've gone from two high to four high, or from two high down to four low, all right? Now, if we do go from two high down to four low, or four high down to four low, the neutral position there is a clue. We have to stop. We must stop. We can't do that while we're moving, but we can move between these two, back and forth, anytime we like, no clutch required, no neutral position on the automatic transmission required, just move the dial, move the lever, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, on the highway, on the gravel, on the highway, on the gravel, on the highway, on the gravel, Just make sure that you switch back to too high before you get onto the highway. You want to be on dirt when you're doing the changing. All right. And make sure it does actually disengage. Make sure it does go back into too high before you actually keep driving on the road. It's really important. Okay, so let's have a look at our four-wheel drive now. We are in a part-time four-wheel drive and we've selected four-wheel drive. So now we're driving the front prop shaft and the front axle as well. We've engaged the front hubs if we have them. So both axles are both driving both sets of wheels. And while we're driving along in a straight line, we've got all four wheels driving. Great, that's what we wanted. Now we turn a corner. Uh-oh, problem. Two inside wheels stop driving because the differential wants, you know, to allow the difference in speed between the inside wheels on the corner and the outside wheels on the corner. So now we're two-wheel drive, except that we're two-wheel drive, one wheel at the front, one wheel at the back. Now, how do we fix that? Well, we can get what are called locking differentials, but they're not really meant to be used in corners. Well, we can have a limited slip differential, which provides a little bit of grip, but it can't allow this wheel to do whatever it wants because it'll break something. So there has to be some amount of slip, limited slip. That's in the name, right? So limited slip means limited drive, right? About 20% drive. So the only way that you can make your wheels, both wheels turn on an axle is to have a locking differential or a locker. But it's very difficult to use those in a corner and you will cause problems if you do. So they're meant to be used in high traction situations where you're driving in a straight line. So the limitation of the four-wheel drive is that when we turn corners, we lose drive at the inside wheels. So when you're driving up a sand dune, don't turn corners, go straight, okay? Go straight. The other thing is if we happen to get light weight on some of these wheels, in other words, we start to lose traction because there's not much weight on the wheel, then whatever wheel doesn't have the weight looks to be to the differential the wheel that's turning the greatest distance, right? Because it's going to happily spin as fast as the car wants it to. The wheel that's tightly stuck to the ground is not going to want to turn, so it's going to act like the wheel that's on the inside of the turn. What that means, in effect, is the wheel that has the grip doesn't get the drive. It's the wheel that doesn't have the grip that gets the drive. And you've seen, I'm sure, videos of four-wheel drives with one wheel up in the air, and the wheel that's up in the air is spinning away, and the one that's on the ground isn't doing anything. And you're wondering, why is that happening? That's why it's happening. It's the differential doing it. So that's the point where you might engage your locking differentials if you had them. Modern cars have something called traction control, but that's not as effective because what it actually does is it puts the brake on that spinning wheel, okay? It applies an individual brake to an individual wheel and says, hey, you wheel, stop spinning. Let that other wheel have a go. But the problem with applying brake is its resistance to forward or backwards movement. So it's not as effective as locking differential. Okay, so what happens in a part-time four-wheel drive? Well, let's get rid of that thing in the middle where they're connected together solidly, and let's replace it with a differential, known as the centre-diff. So that centre-diff, just like these diffs, allows the outputs, in this case, instead of axles, there are two outputs and they are the prop shafts or tail shafts. It allows them, one to drive and one not to drive, depending on which one has the greatest resistance. The one that has the greatest resistance doesn't get the drive. Same as the differential on the axles. So now we can potentially be in a situation, say we're turning a really sharp corner, this wheel here wants to stop turning, this wheel here wants to stop turning, but here's the catcher. Look at the difference in the turning circle. The front wheels turn much wider than the back wheels, so the front axle has to go a different speed to the rear axle, so one provides resistance to the turn, to the rotation, and the other doesn't. One, the front, in this case, will happily go along, right, at the speed that the engine's driving. The back one's going, ooh, slow up, I'm not going that fast, slow up, I'm not going that fast. It provides resistance The centre-diff, therefore, lets it slip. So now how that means we've got no drive at the rear axle. We've only got drive at the front axle. We're going around a corner, so now we're one-wheel drive. So is a full-time four-wheel drive really truly full-time four-wheel drive? Afraid not. And here's the thing, it can't be. There's no way in the world, now that you know how these systems work, that you could have all four wheels driving and be on a really hard surface, because all these four wheels would be have really good grip, and they all want to turn different speeds when you're driving the highway, going around the corners and all that sort of thing. They're all trying to go at different speeds. If you physically connected them together, locked them together, then you couldn't drive. You would break something. So it's impossible to have full-time four-wheel drive. Can't happen. What you have is four-wheel drive without selecting four-wheel drive. You sometimes have four wheels driving. You mostly don't. But you didn't have to change the lever position. That's what it actually means. It's a marketing term. So, as I said, when you look at the selector positions in a full-time four-wheel drive, you need to treat this four high here as though it's actually mostly two-wheel drive, sometimes four-wheel drive. And then it starts to make sense. The four high locked position is the actual four-wheel drive high range. And then the four low locked position is low range four-wheel drive. So that's how you treat a full-time four-wheel drive, okay? That's how it works. So what does this four high locked and four low locked actually mean? Well, just as we talked about, you can have a locking differential here. You have a locking differential in here, which connects those two together solidly, right? So when you lock the center differential by engaging one of these L positions or pressing the diff lock button on the dash on some models, what happens is you lock this center differential and you solidly connect those front and rear axles together. Now, if you turn a corner on really grippy surface like concrete or tar, then you will risk doing some damage. All right, so don't drive in these locked positions on the highway, on the tar, backing your caravan up your driveway or anything like that, right? You need to be in the unlocked position. So I hope that's all helpful. I hope that all makes sense. If you've got any questions, send them to me.